Well, thank you all for coming, and thank you, Hannah, for organizing this, and all of you in the group. It's always a pleasure to talk about my first baby. Sharon and My Mother-in-Law actually is the one book that happened by pure accident. I don't know how many of you know that. But I have spent all my life being an architect, and I contemplated being many things. And my mother always thought that I should be a lawyer because I speak so much. And they said, you will win all the causes because the judge will be just tired of you talking. And actually, I, looking back at things now, I always wonder why I became an architect. And I always say that I grew between two worlds. One, my mother is Syrian from Damascus, and my father is from Jaffa. And I grew as a refugee in Jordan. And as I talked the other day, there was the presence of my mother, who is a very strong character as a Syrian woman. And Damascus has a city that leaves really a lot of images in your brains. But I also lived in the absence of a city, which is Jaffa, in the absence of a country, which is Palestine. And growing up as a refugee in Jordan, I always had to imagine how Palestine looked like, how my father's house looked like. And I always say that I became an architect because I built models in my mind for how Palestine looked and how my father's house looked. And this is, I always tell the story as a romantic story, but in reality, actually, I became an architect just because I am dyslexic. And most artists and most dyslexic, I'm sure if you make a survey, we don't know it, but we go to architecture and we go to art because we are color, we are letter blind, they call us. So this is only an introduction to tell you that the last thing, really, I never thought that I will become a writer. Until one day, Sharon reoccupied the occupied Ramallah with his army in the year 2002, if you all remember, when he sort of surrounded Arafat's headquarters and put Arafat under, the whole town actually were put under curfew for 44 days. And my mother-in-law, who was 91 years old at that time, she was living just close to Arafat's compound. I don't know how many of you remember how terrible that period was. There was bombardment, there was no electricity, there was no water, they closed the water, they closed the electricity. It was really very, very tough, and they put us under curfew for 44 days. And I don't know how many of you have been under curfew, but when you are under curfew, you lose the time. One thing you don't really remember where you are and what you do is the time. But anyway, at that time, I had a part-time husband who is always traveling, and I am always traveling, so I was on my own. And my mother-in-law, who was 91 years old, who is a very stubborn woman, more stubborn than me, was living, thanks God, she was also living on her own. And anyway, for 12 days, we were under curfew, and I couldn't go and reach, get my mother-in-law to come and stay with me, because everybody, when I arrived there, I realized that everybody in the building has left except her and another old woman. Anyway, to make a long story short, I ended up bringing my mother-in-law to come and stay with me under curfew. I always tell the Israelis, I may one day forgive you for all the atrocities you did for the Palestinian people. You kicked us out of our homeland, you destroyed our houses, but one thing I shall never forgive you for is having my mother-in-law with me for 42 days or 44 days. I always felt they felt like 44 years. She drove me crazy, I drove her crazy. And just to give you an idea, my mother-in-law is a very, very, Allah yarhamha, she died. She was a very elegant woman and also very organized. And she lived as if there was no curfew, as if there was no war, as if every morning she would wake up and she will dress up and we will set the table. as if we have guests coming. And I mean, she was in total denial. And actually thinking about her, she is my symbol now. Now that she died, she had become my idol woman. Because she represents how resilient the Palestinian people are, you know? It's just, nothing is happening. We are victorious. We don't have an occupation. And we are going to live our life. And really, we spend the whole time fighting. I remember the day I went to go and get her from her house. And I described this this event. This is Sharon and my mother-in-law. And this is, by the way, Noura, my dog, which is my favorite story in the book. I will probably share it with you. But Hannah told me just to talk for 40 minutes. I have to be very short. But anyway, the day I went to get my mother, really, I mean, the Israelis have given us like 1 hour, and we live in a town that has 70,000 people between Ramallah and Al Biri, the twin towns. And the Israelis will only allow few shops to open. And you had 70,000 people going out to shop all at the same time in 4 or 5 shops only. And it was a madhouse. You really have to be a basketball player to be able to shop and throw it over there for somebody to catch it and pay it. And all of this was happening when Jenin was under, you know, being bombarded. Nablus was under, you know, people were under the rubble. And here we are with my mother-in-law. It's just like we would come back and she, the day I went to get her, it took me 3 times to be able to reach her. Eventually I did, and she was crying because she had no water. The food, I mean, really, the food has gone bad in the fridge. And for her, the bad food in the fridge was worse than losing all of Palestine, as far as she was concerned. She was so disheartened by losing the standard of her living. Then I say, yalla, yalla, mama, we have to get going. And she looks at me and she says, what shall I dress? It's just like, for God's sake, you know? It's like, just come as you are. You know, we're not going to any party. We're not going anywhere. Just we're going to get out of here, and we only have 1 hour. Otherwise, they'll impose the curfew again. And she opens her cupboard, and she looks at me, and she says, do you think my purple dress would be nice? It's just like, yes, mom, purple is wonderful. And do you think yellow would go with purple? It's like, yellow goes with everything. Really, we went on and on and on, and she would not budge. You know, it's like, what shall I take with me? Shall I leave my jewelry? Shall I take my paintings? Shall I do this? And at one point, I just lost it. I said, for God's sake, let's go. Let's go. And then she looks at me and she says, but you know what? That's what happened in 1948. We thought we're going for a few days and we never came back. And that point I understood that really she, oops, did not want to leave, basically. Anyway, excuse me if I get emotional. So anyway, I had to sort of pack M. Salim and, you know, force her into coming. And on the way she kept saying, but it's crazy. I said I'm not going to leave my house ever again because I left it. I mean, between her house and my house was like 1948 revisit of what happened to her. Okay, so we come back, and next morning at 6 o'clock, she comes to my door. Saad, get up. We're going to have breakfast at 7. It's like, for God's sake, I just slept at 3 o'clock. What do you mean you slept at 3 o'clock? We have to get breakfast ready. What are we having for breakfast? It's like, I don't know. It's like, I need to boil my milk. Which is the casserole for boiling the milk? It's like, I have no idea. Just boil your milk in whatever casserole I have. It doesn't matter. And so it went on and on and on for 44 days, you know? And it's like, I want to do marmalade. It's like, fine. Do we have enough sugar? Yes, we have enough sugar. But what if I use all the sugar and they don't uplift the curfew? It's like, we will be without sugar. But we cannot be without sugar. But do you think we'll go and be able to get sugar when they leave the curfew? Maybe we will be, maybe we won't be, but, you know, just do the marmalade, fucking marmalade, just do it, you know? And then she would start, this is a 91 years old, she's trying to make the marmalade, and then she comes to me, but I am tired, my shoulders are hurting. Here I am, I have to come and finish the marmalade she's doing. It's like, leave the marmalade. No, but we cannot leave the marmalade because the marmalade is going to spoil. Okay, so what I do is the following. To save my sanity from my mother-in-law, but also from Sharon's army, which is literally was outside my door. And I cannot tell you, my house is here, and in front of us there is an empty piece of land, and in that empty piece of land, there are 13 tanks, Israeli tanks, just going like this, you know. And you're not allowed to go outside the house to the garden even. And I remember there was a point in a curfew before where my husband wanted to make cappuccino in the middle of the night. And, you know, it's just like, Salim, don't use that cappuccino machine because you might be killed because of the noise, you know. Literally, they were outside, and with the cappuccino machine, they will think that you have a clutching cough, you know. So anyway, to save my sanity, at the end of the day, I decided, okay, I'm gonna write one story I write about the internal occupation that I had in the house. And when the Israeli occupation, when the Israelis uplift the curfew, I'm gonna write a story about the Israeli Sharon's army. Sharon and my mother-in-law. One day Sharon, and the book, as you will all know, I don't know how many of you have read the book? Yeah, one third, which is good. I mean, I'm glad that two thirds will still be reading it. Reading it. And, you know, I would write her and she would write back, oh, aunt, I'm so sorry you're going through all of this, but they are so hilarious. Please continue writing. And then I would write to Luisa Morgantini. I don't know how many of you know this lady, Italian lady who's very pro-Palestinian. All her life has been coming to Palestine and doing work for Palestine. And she was the vice president of the European Parliament at one point, at the time when I was with my mother-in-law. And so I used to lend to Luisa, I mean, five people. And I would write them send them the emails and say, please don't share with anybody, you know. And one day I receive a phone call from Luisa Morgantini, and she says, Saad, do you mind if I make copies and distribute them to the parliament, the European parliamentarians? It's like, Luisa, are you out of your mind? Are you out of your mind? What do you mean give them? You know, you think that the parliamentarians will be interested in the sugar and in my mother-in-law making the marmalade and, you know, with... And she said, Saad, you know, I've worked for Palestine. I read a lot about Palestine. But, you know, I was so moved when I read this. And I really think that this, I said, okay, I mean, if you're crazy, they are as crazy as you are. Make copies. Okay. Then she calls me or she writes me and she says, you know what, Saad? I'm going to send this book to a publisher in Italy. I said, these Italians, I love them, you know, I just love the Italians. Okay, I said, do whatever you want. And then, you know, one day I remember I was in Sweden in a architectural conference, and I received this phone call. And there is somebody on the line says, hello, is that Suad Amiry? Yes. He says, I am Alberto Rollo from Feltrinelli. Feltrinelli, what is Feltrinelli? I had no idea. I said, what? I thought maybe it's a country in Africa somewhere, you know, it's just like, I didn't want to show that I don't know this country or the capital of that country. So I said, excuse me, but what is it? He says, we are an Italian publisher based in Milano. He realized that I have nothing, you know, I had no idea what Feltrinelli was. And by the way, for those of you who are like me, Feltrinelli is like the Kennedy family. Like somebody say, I'm a Kennedy, and you say, Matt, mean, who are you, you know? So he says, you know, I received the manuscript. It's like, what is manuscript? You know, we architects know how, you know, like elevations, sections, perspectives, models. Okay, he received that. And then he says, and I read it, and I really loved it, and I want all world's rights. World's rights, like Rolls Royce, sounded to me like Rolls Royce. It's like, what do you want? He says, world's rights. It's like, what's going on here? So I said, excuse me, but I don't understand. What does it mean, world's rights? And I'm sure he was saying, what kind of an author are we getting? You know? So he tells me, we want to buy all languages. That's what it means. Oh, I said, but Arabic is not for sale. All of a sudden, I got very nationalistic about my own language. I'm not going to sell Arabic to anybody. No, it's no way. Arabic is not for sale. And he says, okay, as you like, you know, it's fine with us, you know. Fine with us, but can you make it to Milano so we sign a contract with you? So I went to Milano, and anyway, just to make a very long story, I meet with him, and I remember, you know, he told me, Saad, I read it, it's very moving between the personal and the political, and then I remember him saying, you have a very nice voice. And I said, is he, you know, is he? It's like, nice voice. Is he hinting? What is this publisher? I mean, you know, in America, you can sue somebody. In America, you know? And then in the Arab world, you can bring your brothers and your uncles, you know, to this guy. But, you know, what do I know? It's just like, really, I swear to God. You know, I understood their world rights and all they had very quickly. But this voice business, I must tell you, it took me 2 years to realize that the guy was talking about the way I was writing. And, you know, it's like you have a voice. Writers have voice, you know. It's just like your voice is very clear. And I realized that it was not exactly my voice that he liked. It was the writer's voice that he read in the book. Anyway, so there I go. I became a writer. And I always say that, you know, and here I'm not bragging, just to entertain you a little bit. It's like I studied architecture 6 years at the American University of Beirut. Nobody cares. I come to Michigan, I do my master's in urban planning, and I study day and night. Nobody cares. I go to Scotland, I do a PhD in architecture, the 19th century, we had a social and social, economic, social spaces, you know. Nobody cares, really. I go back to Palestine, I make this RIWAQ, you know, establish a center for the protection of cultural heritage in Palestine. Nobody cares. And there comes my mother-in-law to listen, to stay with me 40 days, and here I am in Australia talking about my mother-in-law, in New Zealand talking about my mother-in-law, in Beirut talking about my mother-in-law, in Cairo, okay, in America, in Washington. And I tell you, this book, it's 10 years. 10 years. 10 years I've been going. Now, on one hand, you know, it's really the most wonderful event that ever happened in my life, because there is nothing more wonderful than an unexpected success, I must tell you. It changed my life, but it also made me realize that I had something that I was never aware of. As you can see, I would love to be on stage, not a writer. This is really what I want to be. You know, I just want to do a one-woman show. That's all what I want to do in life. I didn't want to be a writer. I never thought of being a writer. And actually, I always thought, you know, to write a book is the following, at least in the Arab culture. I don't know how many of you know Arabic, but Arabic is one of those languages that is very complicated. Why? Because we have the classical Arabic that we read, but we never speak, and then you have the colloquial Arabic. So for me, when I was a little kid, this is what I thought a writer is. It's like you bring all the dictionary, you pile them up here, and then you open the notebook, and then you start looking. It's like, what are I to? I saw. No, what are I to is too colloquial. It's just like you start opening these dictionaries and copying all the difficult words, putting them together, and that is what a writer is all about. At least this is what I thought. But the one thing that I never realized or made the connection is between the Hakawati. You know what a Hakawati is? It's the storyteller, which I have always been. You know, la mama, 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 don't tell the joke. I want to tell it, don't tell it. In the house, nobody was allowed to tell any story. It's like me, you know? It's like, no, I tell it. Please, mama, don't tell it. Oh, brother, shut up, I want to tell it. But I never know, I knew, really made the relationship between being a Hakawati, a storyteller, and a writer. Why? Because I always thought writing is about language. I never thought that writing is about having a story. And only when I made that connection is like Alberto comes again and he says, Saad, maybe you don't know it, but you're a writer. I'm like, okay. And we need another book from you. Okay, another book. 3 months, trick. Another book, you know. Okay, another book. And I send, and basically, as I'm telling you the story now, I write them exactly, and that's why many people tell me, when we read your book, we sort of hear you. But I must tell you, as much as I love this book, I also hate it. I hate it so much, because every time I'm about to write a new book, it's like I come to it. Well, like, how did it happen? Tell me, you know, why are you successful? How can I? And what I did, actually, I want to share with you my trip of writing, because it has been almost 10 years now. I purposely stayed away from writing something similar to Sharon and My Mother-in-Law. Meaning that I didn't want to keep the same style, the same way. I believed that I was a writer. So I started writing things away from Sharon and My Mother-in-Law. So the next book I wrote was something called Menopausal Palestine. Or Alberto did not like Menopausal Palestine. And Menopausal Palestine happened when Hamas won the elections in Palestine, and Fat and PLO, which I am a generation of that movement, you know, we were losing grounds politically. And I just felt that the PLO was like us going through real serious menopause, of feeling not attractive, of having doubt about their sex life, having life about, you know, whether they control their people or not. So I write this book, moving between Hamas and PLO, and, you know, the movement as a movement losing its control, its beauty, its sex life, and what have you. And actually, it is a book about my woman friends, because it happened at a time when Hamas, I don't know how many of you recall, when Hamas won the elections, I just felt that at that time I have spent 35 of my life trying to tell the world that Palestinians are just normal human beings, you know. The world and Israel never really made peace with Arafat, with the PLO, because they never wanted to make peace, but anyway. And as a result, we ended up, everything we ended up having a fundamentalist religious group in our country. And I felt very, because I grew up really in a very, very secular family. And of course, I am part of the PLO generation, and I knew how women participated in the women, especially on the left. I mean, with the Democratic Front, with the Popular Front, women really took a leading role in that organization. So I decided to make interviews with women friends, and that's what I wrote, you know, I wrote menopausal, or I changed it in Italy, it's called No Sex in the City. Anyway, now, before I move to this book, I want to share with you one of my favorite, utterly favorite stories. And if I ever make a one-woman show, it will be this story in here about my dog. But before I do that, I'm just gonna tell you the last thing. This book just came out a few months ago from Bloomsbury here in New York, and it came up in Arabic and Italian and other languages. And this book is a bit different, and it's, again, it's called Golda Slept Here. And it really addresses the loss, what it means to lose one's home, and what is the impact of losing one's home, and home and not country. Because I always feel that we Palestinians and Arabs and all of those internationals who support the Palestinian cause have been talking about a country. And the country sometimes gets very abstract. What does it mean to really lose a country? But I felt that, you know, most Palestinians, when they talked, really they talked about losing a house, losing a home, losing a photo album, losing a dog, losing a horse, losing a bayara, you know, an orange grove. No one talks about, I mean, the politicians, we talk about losing Palestine, but when I sit with my grandma, she doesn't talk about losing Palestine. She always tells me about her house in Jaffa. She always tells me about her neighbors, how she misses the neighbors. So I started thinking that, you know, I want to address that. And that book happened in a very particular moment in the 60 years of Nakba. I don't know how many of you are aware. Nakba means the catastrophe, which is the 1948, expelling almost 750,000 Palestinians from their homeland. Now, when those people were kicked, a lot of property was left behind. A lot of cities, lots of villages, lots of schools, kindergartens, farms, shops, clinics, name it. Fishermen losing their boats, farmers losing their cattle, a person losing their dog, another losing their horse. I always wonder what happened to the cattle, only the animals. I don't care about the Israelis. I don't care about the Palestinians. What happened to the animals in that war? Who fed them? Who gave them water? So I just moved into a completely different, not a nationalist agenda. I don't want to talk about Palestine. I don't want to talk about Israel, because that also takes me into a seminar at the Hebrew University. You know what I mean? There was Palestine, there wasn't Palestine, there was one day where God fell, no, there wasn't, you know? It's like, who's gonna challenge me about my house in Jaffa? Raise your hand. Tell me this is not my father's house. I don't care what you call us. You know what? Call us watermelons. Don't call us Palestinians. I don't care for all of this. But challenge me. I want to challenge you on my house in Jaffa. Come and tell me this was not my neighbor. Come and tell me this was not my shop. Come and tell me. And I don't want to go 2,000 years, neither 60 years. I just want to go right now. And what I did actually is just took four people or five people, and my mother-in-law is in it also, just for you to know, even though she died and Sharon both died, but she's still in this book. And what I do, I take four characters or five, and I see how they handle the trauma of losing a home. And you have to realize that 70% of Gaza are refugees from what came Israel. There are 19 refugee camps on the West Bank. So not all refugees are in America or Lebanon or Syria or in the Arab world who cannot make it to their homes. But you have people living in East Jerusalem who are 2 kilometers away from their home. What does it mean to go at night to your house and find a light in that house, find a family living there, see somebody reading a book, wondering if this is one of your father's books, wondering if the furniture that you left in that house was still there? So I take four people and I physically go with them actually and just tell their stories. One of them is Gabi Baramki, some of you may know. He was the president of Beer Zeit University. And there is a concept, I don't know how many of you are aware, there is a legal concept in Israel. We are called the absentees. We are absentees even if we are physically there. All of us who came from what became Israel, even if they are in, we are in East Jerusalem or in West Bank or in Gaza, when it comes to our properties, when Arabs in Jerusalem are supposed to pay taxes, they are very present when they, it comes to paying taxes. But if they go and say, this is my house and I want it, they will say, they may acknowledge that it's your house in a court, but then they would come and say, but you are an absentee. So this book deals with this whole concept of how you can be physically there, but at the same time, legally, as far as the Israelis are considered, are Now, why is it called Golda slept here? Just a note. Because I don't know if some of you know a lawyer by the name of George Psharat, who is in, he's a professor of law in San Francisco. He teaches there. And actually, Golda in 1948 lived in his house, took his house, the Psharat house, and she lived there. And when Hammarskjöld came to visit her, the UN came to visit her in her house, this villa, the Psharat villa, its name was Harun al-Rashid. And Harun al-Rashid is a Abbasid caliphate, which is the symbol of Baghdad and the richness. So it was called, the villa was called Villa Harun al-Rashid, just as a symbol. And it had Armenian ceramics with Arabic writing on it. And what Golda did, she ran, brought workers, and she sandblasted the tiles so Hammarskjöld would not read, would not realize, or the delegation. But if you go now, the villa is still there, and you would still, I actually have photos of it. But I leave it, I leave this one, and I go back to why I'm here, Sharon and my mother-in-law. The one story I would really love to share with you is my favorite. I maybe have told it too many times, but I always like to tell it one more time for you. I always loved dogs. Actually, my mother loved animals. Both my parents loved animals. And there was a point at home we had, name it, a cat, a dog, rabbits, 200 pigeons, two gazelles. And I grew up, when I came to this world, I grew up with a dog called Mickey. And Mickey used to take me to school and bring me back from school every day. She died at the age of 13. So I really have a very good rapport with dogs. And to a point where my husband sometimes complained that you speak to Noura more than you speak to me. And it's true, actually. At least she listens and obeys. So, anyway. One time I was in Jericho and I adopted, I found a little dog in the street. I went and brought it home, and little I realized it's a, I don't know if anyone knows, stray dogs in Arabic is called baladi. And baladi in Arabic means my country at the same time. I don't know what is the relationship between a stray dog and my country, but this is the Arabic language, So I had this stray dog who came, and I called him Antar, not realizing it was a she. I gave the name before looking at her. So Antar, Antar is a figure of like the strong macho man. And here is a dog, a baladi dog, a female with a name of Antar. Anyway, so she needed a vaccine. I ask around and they tell me, there is this Hisham, Dr. Hisham in Ramallah. They give me his name, I call him, I tell him my name is so-and-so, I have a dog, and could you please come, I need to give her a vaccine. my dog a vaccine. He says, come, Dr. Hisham comes, you know, his suitcase, very stiff. He has his bag with him. And, you know, I take him to the living room and we sit there. And of course, what do Palestinians start talking about? The occupation, the Israelis, 1948, Balfour Declaration. And, you know, it's just like, okay. And he just kept at it. And I say, I'm poor, Antar, you're never gonna get that vaccine. So I sort of interrupted. I said, doctor, can we just have the vaccine and we continue solving the Palestinian issue later? Okay. Bring your dog. And then he says, and what breed is your dog? I said, breed? What kind of a breed? I said, Baladi. And he looks at me, yee, Baladi? You want me to give a vaccine? What do you need a Baladi, a stray dog for? I say, okay, what a vet, you know? So I opened the door and the dog was out in the garden. I opened the door and there comes Antar. And Antar is by that time has reached this size, you know? The doctor, Hisham, looks at the and he says, she's a bitch. And I said, yes. And he said, you want to spend $30 on a stray bitch? And I cannot tell you how my feminist and nationalist feelings came together, you know? Really, I was just like, you know what, Dr. Hisham, I'm gonna take that injection and give it to you. That's what I wanna give. So anyway, he said $30, he gives the vaccine to that dog, I give him the $30, end of story, I don't want to see him anymore. Okay, meanwhile, that dog is gone and I acquired this little thing, Manchester toy terrier, and very, I was very happy that now the vet asked me that dog has, you know, a name. A type, whatever. But unfortunately or fortunately, it was still a she. So anyway, I was not going to take her to Dr. Hisham anymore. No way. So I asked my secretary, I said, do you know of any vet, you know, because I don't want to go to that stupid Hisham. She says, really, I don't know anybody in Ramallah. But, you know, Saad, I'll tell you something. I know an Israeli vet. What? An Israeli vet? She says, yeah, I take my cat to Israeli vet, but I can't tell you how kind she is. It's like, listen, Samah, I personally don't go to Israeli doctors. I personally don't go to Israeli anything. And I'm not going to take my dog to an Israeli vet. No way. And she says, not only that, she's in a settlement. I said, you must be out of your mind, you know? A settlement. And remind you, that was around the 90s when I was part of the Palestinian delegation to the Israel. So I had my official status that I had to protect. So Amnoura was there as we were talking, Samah, and I, my dog was sitting there in the office. I always took her, by the way, to the office. And she looks at me, and when we go home, she comes to me, and she looks at me, and she says, Mom, what do I have to do with the conflict between Israel and Palestine? Tell me. And you know, Noura has ears this big that she can convince you of anything, you know? What do I have to do with this conflict? And how do you know I am Palestinian? Maybe I am a settler myself. It's like, stop it, a settler in my house, stop it. A week passes and then it's just like, she's gonna be sick, she's gonna be, I said, Noura, she jumps here. Noura, I want to tell you something, Habibti, but don't tell anybody, no. She goes like, no. And says, Noura, Habibti, I'm gonna take you to that, but don't tell anybody. Put Noura in the car, and I don't know how many of you here is Ramallah, there is Qalandia checkpoint, and before Qalandia checkpoint, there is a little industrial zone in here, and the settlement is there, and the doctor is there. So I zoom. And, you know, I wear something that, you know, hide myself a little bit just in case. And I get there, and sure enough, we arrive, and there is Dr. Tamar, a British English. Very nice vet. She takes Noura and she cuddles her and she looks in her eyes. She looks in her, open the mouth. And then I say, where are you, Dr. Hisham, just to see how Israelis treat these dogs. So, and then she tells me, and what breed is she? She's like, Manchester Toy Terrier. You know, it's just like, yeah, of course I know. And she, okay. How old is she? Is like, 1 year, because somebody gave it to me. I didn't know exactly when she was born. So anyway, Dr. Tamar goes, and I come, Noura, you see, Habibti, she's treating you nicely. And then Dr. Tamar comes in, and she tells, Suwan, I don't correct my name, yes. Yes. And she says, where does Noura live? It's like, Noura lives with me. Oh my God, we're in trouble. And where do you live? I live in Ramallah. You know, Ramallah, but it's difficult to swallow all of Ramallah, you know? And she looks at me, she says, you live in Ramallah? I said, yes. She goes like this. It's like, what is it? What is it, Dr. Tamar? I understand. I fully understand you discriminate against us. I fully understand that. But to discriminate against my little dog, that, well, what is it? What is the story? And she says, you know, the vaccines we have here are from West Jerusalem, and they are only for West Jerusalem dogs. I said, you mean these vaccines are only for Jewish dogs and not for Arab dogs? And she said, no, don't put it in these terms. I said, in what terms? I mean, this little thing needs a vaccine. Let me see what I can do about it. She goes out and she comes back. And she says, you know what, Suwan? If you pay $30, because those for the West Jerusalem, they're for free. But if you're willing to pay $30, we can give it to her. I said, exactly the same price like Dr. Hisham. Go for it, of course, you know. So she gives her the vaccine. She goes out and she comes back. I wish I had a copy of it. I forgot it. She comes back with a document. And that document says a passport here. Hey. And I look, I say, Noura Habibti, look what you're getting. Look what you're getting. And Noura says, and then the Dr. Tamar comes and, you know, starts filling the application, you know, like name, Noura, Mama, we don't know, Baba, we don't know. Hello, Terrier was born, address, Ramallah. I wish I had it, so. And then she says, do you have a photo? I said, my photo. She says, no, not your photo, your dog's photo. I said, you think I'm American who put their kids, you know, their photo of their kids in their purse, go around? No, I don't have a photo. She says, never mind. Then as we're leaving, the Dr. Tamar says, Suwan, before you go, when you go to Tel Aviv airport, make sure to take the passport. I said, Tel Aviv airport? Noura Habibti, Noura, you recognize what's happening here? Do you realize you are getting a document that 4.5 million Palestinians will kill for? I can't go to Tel Aviv. You know, none of the Palestinians are allowed to go use Tel Aviv airport. And here is Dr. Tamar. He's like, when you go to Tel Aviv, take this passport. It's like, Noura, Mama, I'm going to go to ED. I told you. And then I came and I was just like, oh my God, what are people in Gaza going to think about this Noura having a passport that allows her to go to Israel, allows to go to Tel Aviv, allows her to go to Tel Aviv airport. So I go and I am holding the passport on my right hand side and Noura and looking, you know, Noura, Habib, to look. And I sit, I put the passport, and I make Noura sit next to me in the seat, and I'm driving the car down. And if I go left, I go back to Ramallah in my office, and if I go right, I go to Qalandia checkpoint. I don't know how many of you have been to Qalandia checkpoint, but a Palestinian like myself, from Ramallah, with a blue plate on it, needs 2 permits at least to go to Jerusalem, permits that they don't give, by the way. So I say, you know what, Noura, let's go to Jerusalem. So I put Noura next to me and she says, yalla mama, let's go. So I go to the checkpoint and, you know, everybody is yellow plate, yellow plate, yellow plate. And there is this woman with a blue plate and a dog next to her. And I just go and the checkpoint. Wait, sa. I stop and the soldier comes to me to the window. He says, where are you going? I said, I? He says, yeah, you. I said, I am going to Jerusalem. And he says, you have a permit? I? No, I don't have a permit. Do you have a permit for your car? For my car? No, I don't have a permit. He looks at his other soldiers. It's just like we have a phenomena here. Come. So, he says, and how are you expecting to go to Jerusalem? I say, you haven't met Noura yet, have you? And he said, Maze. I said, you heard me. I said, wait a second. And there are 5 soldiers like around me. It's just I take the passport and I show it. I say, you see this passport? And he looks, it's like, yes. And you see Noura, and of course, Noura by now, she's here and her head out of the window and she's like very proud and yeah. And I say, you see that is Noura, that dog is Noura here, you know? And he says, yes. And I say, and she is from Jerusalem. And I say, okay. And she's, look, the age, she's less than 1 year old. She doesn't know how to drive. Yes. And I happen to be her driver. The soldiers is like, oh my God, what do we have here? He looks at me and he said, you know what? Go! Well, this was 96. And I started having a kick out of that passport. I don't tell you how many times. I just, whenever I'm bored, whenever I'm mad, whenever I'm everything, I just take Noura and I go to any checkpoint. I just use Noura sometimes here when I come to immigration in New York. It's just like I put first Noura's, then I take it back. I've made, and every time, one of the reasons I did not bring Noura's passport with me now, you know why? Because every time I made the presentation, Noura's passport was stolen from the audience. No, I'm joking, you know. Anyway, I stop here and I thank you and I leave it to you to...